scenario. So how do we screen for this? So we now know what are the signs that we need to report. We know what are the pitfalls that are there based on the ultrasound imaging. So how do we put it into clinical practice? So when you image the placenta the second trimester, use a definition of 2 centimeters to define a low-lying placenta. And if there is a background significant history, make sure a detailed placental assessment is done by an expert. Like how we get an expert to do an assessment of the anomalies if we find or if we suspect a problem. When we suspect a problem in the placenta, we need to give it that much importance. With respect to first trimester imaging, are there any signs that might preclude to a placenta that may become adherent later? There is no significant imaging signs that are there, but one recent group of evidence has provided information that if you see a very, very low lying or low implantation of the gestation sac, then that may be a harbinger of placental adherence, especially in someone with a prior surgical history. So this recent paper on early trimester screening, if you have this specific history and you see a very low implantation of the sac and you see the same signs as early as the first trimester, then it may give you a pointer. Point to note this particular case. This was a second gravid of the previous cesarean section. At the early pregnancy, the gestational sac was implanted low in the cavity and the placental cystic spaces were seen as early as 12 weeks. And this pregnancy progressed and by 25 weeks, we saw this morbidly adherent placenta based on all the 4 signs that I've shown. And this pregnancy had a significantly adverse outcome, severe antepartum hemorrhage at 28 weeks, resulting in a cesarean hysterectomy. The baby was lost and the mother barely survived. Hence, understanding these signs is very, very essential to take a decision on which direction we need to go. And I just defined this whole spectrum as one single word called as a PAS spectrum. And what is this PAS spectrum? This PAS spectrum is simply a methodology of reporting on ultrasound, which correlates with the FIGO postnatal grading of an adherent placenta. And I will give you a brief on this and stop this talk there. So what is PAS spectrum zero? PAS spectrum zero is where you have a placenta that is covering the internal loss, but there are none of the signs of invasion as we have just learned. This is PAS zero. You have a placenta covering the internal loss, retroplacental zone is there, there are no lacunar spaces, and color Doppler shows no hypervascularity or bridging vessels, and you can see a very clean bladder line interface. That's PAS zero. Then when you come to PAS one is when you see at least 2 of these signs. What are 2 signs? That is, you see at least 2 placental lacunae that are large and you do not see the retroplacental clear zone. If these 2 signs are there, then you report it as PAS1 in your ultrasound reporting. Let's look at this particular case. And we have seen that the placenta is low lying. And in this particular case, we are not able to image the retroplacental clear zone. The retroplacental clear zone is not seen as well as it. And you are also tending to see a few cystic areas in the placenta. With the presence of 2 markers, this gets reported as PAS spectrum disorder type 1. What is PAS 2? You need to now move on to switching on color Doppler. And you switch on color Doppler and you see that hypervascularity which I have defined. And what is PAS 3? You not only see hypervascularity, but you also see hypervascularity in the lower segment and it extends in the parametrial region. And you also see these bulges into the bladder, which means it is a placenta percreta, which is PAS 3. Another image of a PAS spectrum disorder stage 2, you have a placenta that is low lying and you have cystic areas and you have these bridging vessels that are there. And this defines a PAS spectrum disorder 2. One more case of a placental spectrum disorder 2, you have again a low lying placenta. And in every image, what I'm trying to reiterate is that I've defined the external loss, I've defined the internal loss, I filled up the bladder a little, I've shown the bladder line, and then I have switched on the color Doppler, which means one after the other, we define the signs and we try to reproduce the signs by transabdominal and transvaginal imaging. And what is the relevance of staging it on this? If you see across the spectrum, if you see past zero, these pregnancies do not tend to have any need for post-delivery transfusion, and the blood loss is not significant, and the surgical complication is almost zero. While you look at the other end of the spectrum of past three, the surgical complication is close to 25 to 28%. There's a need for transfusions, and there is a risk of high chance of preterm delivery, and the risk of blood loss of more than 1 liter at the time of delivery is there. So this gives you some clinical perspective into how to interpret this and also prepare the theater and prepare what you need to do and prepare the patient also. And this is again a very useful table which was published in this very recent paper, where they simply tried to correlate the postnatal FIGO staging of the placental adherence to the PAS grading. And what was seen was that PAS 1 was reported as FIGO staging 3 or placenta accreta histopathology. PAS 2 is FIGO staging 4 or a focal placenta percreta or a diffuse placenta percreta. PAS 3 is where it involves a parametrium completely, which is a very, very advanced stage. We hardly tend to see PAS 3. We only tend to see PA stage 0, 1 or 2 when we do the assessment. Is there any role of MRI? I would take a stop here for a few seconds again to go back and reiterate this. All these signs individually have a very, very high negative predictive value, which means absence of those signs nearly rules out an adherent placenta, which gives us enough amount of reassurance. And the positive predictive value as an individual sign is less, but when you link all, the positive predictive value becomes significantly more, which means beyond ultrasound, MRI adds very, very less value to assess the placental adherence spectrum. And the availability and the reporting skills of MRI for placental adherent disorders is not as high again. We have had significant amount of discrepancies in the placental adherent spectrum disorder reported on MRI and with respect to the ultrasound, where we have seen that the ultrasound reporting has been much more accurate. This is in turn very much related to the skill set of the operator who can report an MRI, because it's not something commonly referred there. And again, the availability of this. So this is an example which I got from my team. This is an example of a placenta that is adherent. And this is again a placenta which has got a heterogeneous spaces that are there. And this is a placenta that is invading the bladder. There's a small amount of bladder tenting that was seen reported on MRI. But actually when we saw on delivery, this baby never actually had a placenta invading the bladder. And this bladder tenting or bladder involvement was not reported on ultrasound also. This is what I was trying to say, that there is a significant amount of discrepancies in the thought process of defining on ultrasound and MRI. So it is, I would say, best to stick to the skill set that we have, which is much more robustly defined, and signs which are much more clear when we report these spectrum disorders. I will leave you with these exercises of placenta, with these four cases, and we will start with case one. And case one is primarily defined to see how do we report it. This is a placenta that is covering the internal loss, very clean placenta, no lacunar spaces, and good retroplacental zone. So the methodology of reporting would be a placenta that is posterior low lying, the lower edge covers the internal loss, it's seen there, no evidence of retroplacental, no evidence of any lacunar spaces, and the retroplacental space is normal. So we have given four signs, all negative predictive value, and the final impression, placenta previa with no evidence of adherent, which means it is PAS zero, which makes it very clear for the clinician that they may not have a lot of problem during the time of delivery. While this is case two, you are having a placenta low lying, hardly any lacunar spaces. The only thing that they are tending to see is a loss of the retroplacental clear zone that is there, and only one sign, and for reporting as pass spectrum one, you need to have at least two signs there. So this would again be a pass zero, and this pregnancy did not have significant problems at the time of the delivery. While this one has two signs, you have lacunar spaces that are there. And when we switched on the color Doppler, we saw these bridging vessels. And this is a very, very significant thing. This is pars spectrum disorder one, which would report as placenta accreta. And this pregnancy had some difficulty during the time of delivery. And the last image that I want to put across is this placenta. You have more than two lacunar spaces, and the lacunar spaces are large. There is obviously no retroplacental clear zone, and there are a lot of bridging tortuous vessels that are there, but the bladder wall interface is still normal. This is pars spectrum disorder two, which is a placenta increta, and this is something that has got a much higher chance of complications during the time of delivery, much higher chance of requiring blood transfusions after delivery, and this is something that we need to prepare our mind. So I'll stop this discussion with these concluding remarks that TAS plus TVS is mandatory to address placental problems. Previous cesarean section with lacunar spaces, most predictive value. Follow a systematic way of reporting the four signs. And previous section, very, very low implantation of sac. Keep a close watch and make it a point to start reporting on the PAS spectrum disorder on the ultrasound report. It would help you to correlate with the postnatal delivery problems, and it will also enable the clinician to have an optimal mode of delivery. Thank you very much for a very patient listening.
Thank you, Dr. Sudarshan. I think that was one of the most brilliant, concise, precise, and wonderful talk. And I wish we could all give you a rising ovation for that talk. And now, I'm very happy to say that our chairperson, Dr. Sanjay Kishore Das, is here. I will request Mr. Amit to unmute. Dr. Sudarshan, I know you're a very busy person, but just like you had a rapt attendance, if you would spare some more time and go with the obstetricians also, we would welcome that. Yeah. May I request Dr. Sanjay Kishore Das, sir, to please say his words of his views. Our theme is practicing safe obstetrics, and nothing better to start with anticipation and then prevent and then manage. I would request Dr. Sanjay Kishore Das. Dr. Deepika? Dr. Sanjay?
Ma'am, Dr. Sanjay is on the screen. Internet is playing some tricks on him. So the internet is gone again, and he's trying to connect back again.
I can see very many friends of mine, and I'm really very thankful to so many of you. Dr. Vedehi from Nagpur, thank you. You're the inspiration for me to do something really good, and you at your young age. Now, I think if we get his connection, then we'll put him on. Let's go on to our next part, and I'll request Dr. Savita Singhal. Please unmute Dr. Savita Singhal. She'll take us through the video highlighting some very important learning steps, because it's all about prevention. Dr. Savita Singhal, over to you.
A very good afternoon to my friends and all the participants. Amit, can you start with the video? It is just a sort of revision. We would like to show this step-wise devascularization. At the outset, I would like to thank Dr. Sumita Mehta, who couldn't make to this webinar. She has given us this video to display. And this step-wise devascularization, very, very important step to prevent the postpartum hemorrhage and even to treat the postpartum hemorrhage. And in this, we go with five steps. Unilateral uterine artery, like, can we start the video? Unilateral uterine artery ligation, bilateral uterine artery ligation. Now this is a step. Now you can see the cesarean has already been done. This uterine scar is seen, and we opened the broad ligaments, just trying to identify the uterine artery. It has been identified, and we take one stitch with the vitrile number one, taking care that some part of myometrium is included in this. And it is very, very easy procedure with very slow learning curve. Everybody can do this with one number vitrile. And now this has been tied. This is the left side. Now same procedure will be repeated on the right side. So after this, two uterine bilateral uterine artery have been ligated. The main advantage is that it can be done in for prevention of PPH, the cases who are very, very high risk. Another thing which can be done, we can put our two fingers behind the broad ligament to raise it so that it will artery will become more prominent and the ureter will fall away. So two fingers can be kept behind the broad ligament, which will help in making the uterine artery more prominent and stitching will be easier. So now bilateral uterine have been ligated. Now double ligation is done. Double ligation means just 2 centimeter below the previous one, means near the uterine edge, we take another bite. The advantage of this double ligation, 2 centimeter below the first one, is that the lower from the uterine artery, some cervical branches are starting. And the branches are being given to lower uterine segment. So they will be included in this. So any hemorrhage, which is from the lower uterine segment or from the cervical region, that will be prevented, especially in cases of placenta previa, when we expect that the hemorrhage might be from the placental bed, then this double ligation of uterine artery, bilateral, at least 2 centimeters below the upper incision, which is near the uterine edge. Now the third step is the ligation of the uterovarian anastomosis. That is again very, very important. The precaution which has some poor quality of video is there. Is it visible? In the back room, yes. We have all the tube, fallopian tube is there. And precaution to be taken is just take from the avascular space. Same suture, one number vital is used. Use the avascular space and take, this is being repeated on the another side. Be careful not to take the tubal part in this. And avascular space is very important. Otherwise, there can be big hematoma, which may be difficult to manage, but it is very, very easy, which can again be done for prophylaxis of the PPH. Now, next step will be the ligation of internal iliac, which is a little long learning curve is there, but in cases of placenta accreta, it is very helpful to ligate the internal iliac, and not very difficult, but at least everybody has before doing it, before benching the internal iliac. Now just see it dissecting the broad ligament. It is taken from this round ligament is being holded, and we're going in the upward Kiffel direction. After the Kiffel direction, this opening of this ligament, just identify the common iliac. Below the common iliac, about 3-4 centimeters, there is the internal iliac artery. Now this is being pointed to ureter. Can you see the movements in the ureter? Very well, mobile was there. Just lateral to the ureters will be the internal iliac artery. After identifying, at least you have to assist few and do one or two before independently mentioning or to this, the various complications which can be there with the internal iliac. Now the artery forces are kept behind the internal iliac, and you have to take one loop of the one number vicryl, or even silk can be taken. One loop is taken so that it can be doubly ligated with that loop only. No need to pass the artery twice below the iliac artery. This loop is being passed. It will be taken out, and then same will be divided so that 2 stitches can be taken from this. Now just cutting the end of the loop and taking 2 stitches. Once tying it, you should be very clear, it should not be too tight and should not be too loose. It can be seen by the blanching of the artery. Blanching is there, it means the suture has been, the ligation has been appropriate. So same will be repeated on the other side. The disadvantage, you can injure the internal like vein, which is just behind it. So everybody, this is just for the revision that how we can ligate the internal iliac artery and the uterine as well as the tubovarian anastomosis, which is very, very easy. Apart from these, other methods are the compression sutures, which can again decrease the incidence of postpartum. Or if atonic postpartum hemorrhage is there, very well one can take the compression suture in the upper uterine segment. And again, compression suture, which is a little difficult for the placental bed, that it shows suture, we say, which can be taken in the lower uterine segment. So everybody should be able to know this, how to ligate the arteries. Now we can go to Dr. Mitra, can we go to the next slides?
Yeah. Can you see my slide show?
Yes, yes, it is clear.
Just 1 second. Okay. So, my dear attendees, my very, very respected panelists, I think we have learned a lot about the placenta, its adherence. And now comes the time we have to live our difficult times. And so we're going to take you through this panel discussion. It is being moderated by Dr. Savita Singhal. She represents the tertiary care doctor. And myself, Dr. Mitra Saxena, I represent all those of my colleagues who are by themselves doing a good job, but all alone. So I'm not going to spend much time on the panelists because they are very well acclaimed, excellent teachers, obstetricians, and skilled surgeons. And let's go on without wasting much time. Welcome all my panelists, Dr. Narendra, Dr. Manju, Dr. Muralidhar Pai, Dr. Manish, and Dr. Hemant Deshpande. Please check your mics. This is going to be a rough ride. We want you to make it smooth for all of us. So this beautiful picture says it all. When we don't respect the boundaries, we are bound to be in trouble. So this decidua or the endometrium, which has suffered disgrace or abuse, the chorionic villi, they just continue to do their job of going through and through the myometrium and the serosa. And this has already been told to us by Dr. Sudarshan, extreme details. So over to you, Dr. Savita. Dr. Savita.
Now the incident we know is thanks to lot of number of cesarean section. As we all know that cesarean section have been increased nowadays. In last 40 years, there is about 10 times increase in the incidence of placenta accreta. And if previous cesarean directly proportional to the number of previous cesarean section. Right. And it adds on to like just like a fire, if previous cesarean section with placenta previa, very, very high chances that patient might be having the placenta accreta. And that may be up to 50 to 60%. So one of the saying is that any patient with placenta previa with previous cesarean section, treat the patient as a placenta accreta unless ruled otherwise. And most of these are associated, 80% are associated with placenta previa. That's why we meet with this situation normally in the cesarean sections, though it can be vaginal delivery also, but fundal placenta little less, that may be up to 20%, but still we see in the vaginal deliveries. And out of these, thank God the placenta accreta, which is little milder type, which is more common into about 60 to 70%, and placenta percreta, which is most dangerous, we see in about 20% of the cases.
Okay.
Dr. Mitra. Yeah, just yeah. The keeping in view pathophysiology of placenta accreta, I'd like to invite the opening batsman for this panel, Dr. Pai. Just please enumerate what are the high risk factors for the placenta accreta. Dr. Yeah. Pai, please.
Yeah, thank you, ma'am. As you said just now, it is the previous cesarean section which is the biggest culprit of placenta accreta. The reason for that is whenever there is a previous cesarean section, there is a scar. And for some unknown reason, the zygote is attracted towards the scar. It's like fatal attraction. And when it gets implanted there, that area is not vascularized properly. Also, as such in the lower segment, the Nitta-Busch membrane, it is something like a slimy layer, like we grease the pan. When we make the cake, we grease the pan so that the cake comes off easily. Similarly, this membrane will help the placenta to come off easily after the delivery. Now, this Nitta-Busch membrane is absent in the lower segment. That's why whenever the placenta is in the lower segment, it gets directly attached on the musculature. And then rest of the things will happen. Either it could be accreta, increta or percreta, it's a matter of just how much it goes inside. So previous cesarean section and placenta previa is a deadly combination. As you correctly said, 80% of the accreta is expected in them only. But it is not just previous cesarean section. Any previous scar on the uterus, for example, if you have done a myomectomy in the past, even that scar also, if the placenta is attached on that scar, there is a chance of placenta there. Plus, if you have for any reason damaged the endometrium, let's say previously you have done a manual removal of placenta, or if there was a damage due to infection, postpartum endometritis, there also the decidua is not well developed and the placenta gets directly anchored there. So if the pregnancy occurs after in vitro fertilization, for some reason there is a chance of accreta, I guess this could be because if there is twins, for example, placenta is very huge. When the placenta is huge, it has no other choice than to go on to the lower segment. And the moment it goes to lower segment, there is every chance that the placenta should go for accreta. In fact, it is a miracle that most of the placenta which are in the lower segment are not going in for very morbidly adherence. Adherence is always there, but somehow for some reason, not everybody will go for morbid adherence. Finally, as the age advances and as there is a multiparity, again, maybe the same reason, the decidua is many times damaged. So that is the reason the anchorage directly occurs on the myometrium.
So thank you, Dr. Pai.
Okay, thank you.
In fact, when you were telling about IVF, I almost felt that you are echoing my two last cesareans of IVF, frozen embryo transfer. Thank you so much.
Yeah.
Now, coming on, hold on to your guns. The first case goes to Dr. Narendra Malhotra. Dr. Narendra Malhotra, please, are you unmuted? Dr. Deepika?
Ma'am, yeah, yeah. Mitra ma'am, can okay. I add something?
Yeah, please do.
I'll just add one more thing because this is a procedure which is seen very commonly.
Dr. Manish,
hello?
Dr. Manish, just hold on. I'm going to call you. I know you're very attentive.
This is pertaining to the previous slide of causes of morbid adherence. And lot of ART consultants are doing hysteroscopy where they do lateral metroplasty.
Patching.
And that becomes one more factor why the placenta would go and adhere there.
Good. Thank you. That's very nice. Okay, so Dr. Narendra Malhotra, the first thing is that this is a role play. You're not Narendra Malhotra, the owner of Rainbow Hospital with a battery of consultants all around you. Every time the anesthetist 24 hours. So imagine you are in my shoes and you did just have to deliver your 26 weeks patient who's gone into labor. You had to remove the stitch. Your nurse informed the fetus has come out and more than half an hour and the placenta hasn't come. How are you going to manage this case? This is a very common thing which is happening to so many of us. So, Dr. Narendra.
So, this could have happened, one, because the uterus is contracted and especially the lower segment has contracted and held the placenta up there. This could have also happened because the placenta is not separated. And as you heard that the slime layer, the Nitzschebusch membrane was not there, or there was a previous infection and because of some chorioamnionitis or infection, because it's preterm and this, that could have happened. There was a cervical stitch that would make me wary that maybe she got some infection and the placenta got mildly adherent, not morbidly adherent. So what I would do is, of course, the Syntrodrip is running or any, if I can slide my hand inside or my long fingers, I will try to separate from the lower segment, slowly separate the placenta from the uterus and go as high as up and then pull it out. Most of the times I'll be able to take it out completely. But there are times when the membranes will remain stuck at the fundus. A lobe might get remained at the sung. In the meantime, because the ultrasound machine is, we have ultrasound machine in our theater always, but I'll wheel in the ultrasound machine and try to see whether we have completely removed it or not. If not, then under the ultrasound guidance with a sponge holder, slowly and slowly we're going to try and pull it out. Uterus should always be contracted, because if the uterus relaxes, then the problem of bleeding and maybe perforation could happen. So this is a very common situation we run into, and especially in second trimester abortions or even an early third trimester preterm deliveries. And it can be managed at a lower center, peripheral center, without asking or without panicking for more help. Of course, you must ask for help. You must give a call to the anesthetist. You must give a call to your friendly gynecologist. Two are better than one, because sometimes if bleeding occurs, you go into a thought block and you're not able to think and do. And you start yelling at the nurse, you start yelling at this thing. And because of your yelling, nobody can find what is where. So an obstetric drill in your small nursing homes is absolutely mandatory every month, every 15 days. You must mimic such cases. And so everyone knows who has to call the blood bank, who has to call the anesthetist, who has to get the laparotomy set ready, who has to get the OT set ready, where is the prostaglandin, where is the syntesnon, where is the methanogen. That drill should be ready.
Thank you, Dr. Naren. So,
Mitra, can I add a comment, please?
Yeah, please do. Please do.
Yeah, actually, what I feel is the large number of times, it could be only a congenital malformation of the uterus. So it is a biconeal uterus and a placenta.
Or even an arcuate uterus.
So one, preoperatively, before we start venturing upon, delivery, center, we can do an ultrasound. It will give us a fair idea. And even the peritoneal examination for any denting in the fundus of the uterus could kind of give you a clue as to what the problem would be.
So I think my panelists can pass me, because this is exactly what I did. I brought the ultrasound machine, but I don't have long fingers. So I had called my anesthetist, and with the anesthesia, etc., we managed, and she didn't have excessive bleeding. Thanks God for that. But now I want Dr. Manish, because do you think it is very important to communicate, and what do you think should be communicated and how? Okay. I want you to add that, because our case will not be complete if we do not have the clinical legal awareness in us for every little case. Dr. Manish.
Okay. Thank you, Mitra ma'am, for this question. One more thing I'll add in this clinical point of view is, this is one good case to use carboprostromethamine, that is prostodin, because it will cause tetanic contractions in the uterus, and sometimes the placenta just separates and comes out. So prostodin is a good drug for these cases. Now, what do you inform? There are two things that you need to inform. A, what has happened, and B, how you are going to manage. Now, at that point in time, if the patient is maybe, not in a condition to give any consent, it's okay. If it is an emergency, if you need to shift to OT, and you can take patient's consent if patient is in a state to give consent. If not, you inform the relatives, whoever is outside. Do not worry about paperwork, especially when there is an emergency. If you have informed, if you have counseled them that what you are going to do, from legal point of view, you are all good. Mentioning in notes, yes, whatever has happened, whatever medicines were given, whatever was resorted to has to be put down on paper. So
thank you so much.
An emergency, do not.
Yeah. So in my case, the patient was awake and I exactly did what you said. So I should be very happy with myself. So I think, Savita, it's your turn to call the next batswoman. Unmute yourself.
Dr. Manju, now it is your turn for the role play. Just imagine that you're not the HOD of Lady Harding. And you're just working at a small place, small nursing home is there, and you're conducting the cesarean section. And same situation is there, that you delivered the baby. Everything seemed to be normal. There was no vascularity, nothing was there. You delivered the baby. And after delivering the baby, now given the syntocinon as well, and you're not able to deliver the placenta. How you're going to proceed?
Right. So this again could be either a morbidly adherent placenta. So that is the first possibility which I would keep in mind when I feel that the uterus is contracted, still the placenta is adherent. So during cesarean, I would kind of do a manual removal of the placenta. But prior to venturing upon it, I should be prepared with blood at hand, because once you start fiddling with the placenta, there can be lots and lots of bleeding. So that is what is very, very important. And however, because the patient is already there on the table and the abdomen is open, so you can comfortably try and remove it. If you are able to remove it, it is fine. In case you are not able to remove it, you should be taking consents for hysterectomy prior to actually venturing upon trying and removing this placenta. So I should be capable of actually doing a hysterectomy before I try removing this placenta. Otherwise, I should seek help, arrange for blood, take consents. So these are the things which has to go on. Consent.
So with the relative- something what happens, yeah, you're able to separate some of the placenta. Some cleavage was there, but at one point, you feel some part of lobe is not coming.
Yes.
It's the same.
So it does happen. It does happen quite a number of times. So because it is under you know, control, the whole situation. So one, you know, either you can, if it, especially if it is in the posterior surface or it is in the fundus, it's much more easier. The problem is that the anterior surface, if you've done a transverse, you know, lower segment cesarean section, to approach the anterior wall is a little difficult. But then one can shave off the placenta or, you know, remove it, excise it. And sometimes, you know, one, you know, we've done a wedge resection also of that particular area and then resutured it. So it would all depend upon, you know, how much is the placenta which is adherent. And sometimes, you know, once you remove it, that surface might bleed. And then one can even apply hemostatic sutures there. And one can even put on CHO sutures there. Both the opposed to each other. So I'm sure all of us must have, you know, done lots of things to do that. But one thing is very sure, this focal accretas are a problem. So, you know, we always tell our residents, in case it is not coming out, please don't start fiddling with it. You must have help, you must have blood. The anesthesia person should also be sensitized. So it is not that you half placenta you would remove and then the patient continues to bleed. And we've had patients who have gone into shock. So one has to quickly move on for hysterectomy in these cases.
Okay, so before we close this case.
I'll just add 2-3 points. Important thing is, if you are suspecting a morbid adherence, the moment you deliver the baby, either in cesarean section or during vaginal delivery, start a timer. Start a timer. And that timer, so you are going to do X thing for next 2 minutes, X thing for next 2 minutes. Doesn't work, you stop. Simultaneously call for help, but start a timer. So you cannot waste time on doing same thing again and again. That's important point. Second point is, now here, what we have seen, the placentas which appear to be adherent, there are two categories of patient. Patient actively bleeding and patient not actively bleeding. If patient is not actively bleeding, just ligate the uterine and wait for some time. Give oxytocin, wait for some time, ligate the uterine, mostly the placenta comes out. Now the whole gamut is, if the patient starts actively bleeding, and it's the patient starts actively bleeding because we fiddle with the placenta, rightly Manju madam said, unless you are not very sure about what is going to happen, unless you do not have a good backup help, do not fiddle. If you do not fiddle, it will not bleed. It will bleed, start bleeding only if you try to fiddle without the correct, you know, procedure, without getting help, without blood. So for the placenta which are not bleeding, what we regularly do is, we take bilateral uterine artery. Sometimes at the origin we take, because of laparoscopy now everybody knows how, but any which ways, the easiest way to take uterine is just above the uterosacral. The uterosacral incision just above and 1 centimeter medial to it, you can 100% find the uterine vessels there. So just take 2 bites, ligate them, wait for good 5 to 10 minutes. Lot of these placentas separate and they come out.
That was very good. That was very good addition. That was an obstetric addition from a medical legal man.
Manju, I work as an emergency obstetrician.
Good, good, good. Dr. Manju,
we would sometimes you know, inject oxytocin intraumbilically also.
Yes, and yes.
They have to be taken before you venture upon anything. Uterine must be taken. And intraumbilical oxytocin can also expedite the, you know, separation. 20 units.
One more legal point is, if this is happening during cesarean section, the patient is already under, even if spinal, so many times anesthetist will give some sedative to allay anxiety, that is not the time to take any consent from that patient.
Absolutely.
So do not, again, I'm very categorically clearly putting, these are emergencies. You need not take any consent. Informing the relative who's standing outside is enough. And that can be done by one of your juniors also. You don't have to de-wash, go outside, talk, then again come. One more thing is, for God's sake, do not get the relatives in operation theater. Lot of people do that. Come, I'll show you how much your patient is bleeding. Please do not do, because if they click photographs, you know, everything can go adverse against you. So no relatives in OT. A good junior person who can counsel can always go and tell whatever is happening. And never take consent. I have seen people take consent of the patient who is in under spinal anesthesia and putting a paper in front of her and taking a, don't do all that, is not needed.
Very valid point.
One last point, Dr. Manju, please clarify for all the attendees that methotrexate, if and all, whenever the lobe is left, adherent lobe, example in a vaginal delivery, what, people put give methotrexate. So please clarify that once and for all.
No, no, methotrexate is not a good drug at all. I have to say, we keep giving methotrexate. It is not to be given. We don't normally give methotrexate. The placental blood supply in any case would kind of stop on its own. And methotrexate has a lot of other side effects. It is not a safe drug. Some patients have lots of side effects. So it is not of any use. And the only thing is, if you, especially for vaginal delivery, sometimes the lobe might be left in vaginal delivery. So that is perfectly okay. We can give them antibiotics for about 4 to 5 days, and we also need not continue giving them antibiotics. So only that initial 3 to 5 days antibiotics can be given, and people tend to give very heavy antibiotics. That is also not required. So only thing is that the patient has to be counseled that there could be some heavy bleeding, and they should be, you know, in a position to come back to the hospital once you have discharged them. So that counseling has to go on. And some people would even remove it hysteroscopically subsequently with the help of scissors. You can also remove that lobe. But methotrexate, no, for my okay. side. No, I would
and
not.
And the evidence also says that there is no role for methotrexate. Mr. Amit, please unmute Dr. Deshpande, who all banded up and padded up. Dr. Hemant Deshpande, are you there?
Yeah, yeah.
Okay, good. Good, sir. You're not the HOD of D.Y. Patel Hospital, University. You are just one of us. And sure. Imagine you get a patient in the middle of the night who is unbooked, and you're a good surgeon, no doubt about that. She hasn't brought any record and she needs to have a cesarean section. And you just open the abdomen. And there at 2 in the middle of night, what is something which will put you off, even though you are the best obstetric surgeon in a happy time? What would you do? What is that which you see and you say, okay, this is wrong?
See the picture, what you are showing here. So many tortuous vessels and distended hypervascular lower uterine segment. 100% going to tell you that with the history of previous section, it's nothing else than a placenta previa accreta, maybe type 4. Because majority of the vascularity is exclusively on the lower part of the lower uterine segment. So here you have to take a decision whether you can do it or whether you can't do it. Before that, most important one, be calm, be cool, have patience, and don't press any panic button. Once you are calm and quiet, then you can have certain things in mind. Decide whether you can do it, whether you can't do it. If you are confident enough, you can do obstetric hysterectomy. You can do a cesarean hysterectomy with cesarean, yes. With all the things, with a good assistant who is competent enough, good anesthetist who can manage the show, a good neonatologist who can take care of the baby, and good backup of the blood and blood products from your very dear blood bank, very close to your hospital, we can do it. If these 4 things are there, yes, and I am confident I can do obstetric hysterectomy or a cesarean hysterectomy, I will definitely proceed. Right. If you have heard my talk on obstetric hysterectomy in Bangalore EICOG, CG Saraiya, CME, yes, we can do it, and every doctor, every obstetrician must do it, but don't be panic. If you have all these 4 or 5 things, we can very well do. If you don't have it, then obviously a simple option, close the abdomen, refer it to the tertiary center where a senior gynecologist, senior obstetrician is available. But yes, most important one, once anesthesia is given, abdomen is opened, it's the role of the obstetrician. do the procedure completely. That's most important one. And I'm going to do the procedure completely. I'm going to do the caesarean hysterectomy, deliver the baby, do a caesarean hysterectomy, and then shift the patient to the ICU, which is in the hospital, and take care of the patient. But at the same time, you should not forget the patient and patient's relative. You have not taken consent for obstetric hysterectomy or a caesarean hysterectomy here. Your junior, your competent assistant must go out, must explain the relatives without bringing them in, as Manish has properly said. Don't bring the relatives in. Let them be there outside. And obviously, nowadays, under camera, you have to take the consent. With a video camera, take their consent properly. Yes, the patient is having the placenta previa accreta. We may have to do obstetric hysterectomy. We may have to proceed with caesarean hysterectomy. Take the consent, arrange the blood products, and then with the good assistant, good anesthetist, proceed for the caesarean hysterectomy. Obviously, losing the abdomen and transferring the patient, yes, but once, my personal opinion, once anesthesia is given, abdomen is opened, we all are competent doctors. Every doctor, every obstetrician must know how to do a caesarean hysterectomy, how to do a caesarean section in a placenta previa, percreta or accreta. We can do the things, provided you have good backup. Without backup, nothing is possible. You must have a good backup, and that's mandatory thing. In the earlier one, madam has already told, to deliver the placenta after the uterine artery ligation, it is easy. But routinely, I always give, even in a normal C-section, 20 units of oxytocin diluted in 20 ml of normal saline in the umbilical vein. Wait for 5 minutes. Placenta will separate on its own and come out. We have done a lot of, we routinely do this. We routinely practice this. 20 units of oxytocin. And even in the placenta accreta, not in percreta. I'm not saying it is in percreta. But yes, in accreta, after the uterine artery ligation, if you give 20 ml of normal saline mixed with 20 units of oxytocin, yes, the placenta separates in more than 90% of the cases, and you hardly require your hand to put and separate the slice the placenta. Madam has told rightly, one lobe may be there or a part of the lobe. We call it either partial or focal placentas. Accreta there, you may have to remove them with the help of the scissors, or you may have to remove it with the help of the MR.
That is very good. Thank you so much, Dr. Hemant Deshpande. So many more things you have added to that one small thing. However, I just wanted Dr. Manish to tell, in case person cannot do the hysterectomy, and if they have to take the decision, because it's a stable condition, they have to close the abdomen, what is the paperwork we may have to do? Obviously, we are making hypothetical cases, but let's prepare our other attendees, because one rainy day, somebody may be really stuck, and then they should not be called negligent, because if they venture and they cause the maternal death, it's better to let the patient be shifted. So Dr. Manish, please wake up.
Yeah, okay. Arise and tell. I'm very much there listening, ma'am.
Yeah.
Very nice inputs given by all seniors and my teachers, everybody is here. Important thing is, since we are discussing this case, and it happens so many times that it's an unbooked patient where we do not know, or the previous records may not show any morbid adherence, etc. And then we are managing. So one practical tip is, if you have done an obstetric hysterectomy, send that uterus with the placenta for histopath examination. Pathology will clearly tell you that it was a case of percreta, and that comes handy very much, because we have done an obstetric hysterectomy when the patient is under anesthesia and only informing the relatives. So medico-legally, it is very good to send this uteri for histopath examination and get the report. That's point number one. Point number two, if we are closing and shifting, then only thing we have to put down on paper is, in good faith to save the life of the patient, the decision taken to shift by the consultant. And if possible, this information is given to the relatives and take their signature. But again, I'll repeat, even if you write on paper that in good faith to save the life of the patient and need for tertiary center, where the diagnosis of morbid adherence was not made antenatally, is good enough for you. Do not wait to, you know, the relative will say, I will call somebody else, I am going to call this and that. So don't wait for that. It is your responsibility to shift the patient to a tertiary center in good condition. So you can shift, no problem. But obstetric hysterectomy, all obstetric hysterectomies, I urge very clear take home, send the uterus with the placenta for histopath, yeah, and get a report, the microscopy which show the villi in between the myometrial fibers, preserve that report. That is our prerogative, and it helps us in case there is a medical legal issue that it was actually this and nothing else for which obstetric hysterectomy was.
Yes, thank you so much. Please do.
In case there is a patient with previous cesarean section, one or two, and placenta previa, and ultrasound mapping has not been done, morbidly adherent placenta has not been done, let everyone take a consent prior to taking that step.
Exactly. That's a very sensible and a logical thing in anticipation. Dr. Manju, you have added one very important point to all the attendees, that anticipate that there can be adherence. So take, and I think that will be comprehensively covered by Dr. Manish at the end. But thank you for putting this input right away. Dr. Savita, now please share your experiences.
We want to share one case. She was unbooked, referred at 35.5 weeks with placenta accreted diagnosis at 35 weeks in middle of the night. Can we shift to next slide? So she was managed by our expert team in the middle of the night at about 2 a.m. where the sort of, Mitra, can you shift the slide? No, previous one. So that she had underwent cesarean hysterectomy at about 2 a.m. in night, and with the, we were lucky enough to have healthy baby and healthy mother without morbidity. She was discharged on 8th day. But the message we want to give, that one is you should go by no touch technique. If they present the accreta, percreta, you are planning the hysterectomy, do the classical cesarean section to decrease the bleeding and then proceed for the hysterectomy. Second, the patient should be referred as soon as diagnosis of placenta accreta spectrum is made, so that even at the tertiary care center, she can better optimize, we can arrange the blood in time, we can keep the patient in elective OT, so that all that hustle in the emergency OT can be prevented, where many of this junior staff will be there at that time, less availability of urologists. So it is better to refer the patient, if you want to refer, at tertiary care as early as possible once diagnosis of placenta accreta spectrum is made.
So thank you, Dr. Manjuri.
Can you give some surgical steps? What are the tips for doing the obstetrical hysterectomy in patients of placenta accreta spectrum?
Yeah. Thank you, sir. Actually, let's understand that, to capture what is happening at the time of doing a cesarean hysterectomy for a placenta, previa accreta, increta or percreta is not so, easy. But a lot of my, thanks to my postgraduates, they keep capturing whatever little they can, kind of see in that whole confusion. So I've just edited a few steps and I think I'll just share my screen and show you that. Could you please stop sharing your screen, Mitra?
Yeah, how do I?
Mitra, please.
Yeah, 1 second. Sorry. Yeah, 1 second.
When you share yours, yeah. Dr. Mitra will stop itself. You start sharing yours.
I stopped it.
Yeah, so this is a, video where I just want to show you that basically, the basic aim is to stay away from the uterus and stay away from the placenta. So let's understand. In normal hysterectomy, we keep our clamps flushing with the uterus, but here the clamps have to be away. And thankfully, when you are dealing with a cesarean hysterectomy, the planes are very good. So the only thing is you should know that you have to be away from the uterus. So I just shared this 4-5 minute video with you. So this was, we've already done a classical cesarean section. And when you give the classical cesarean section incision also, there also you should be away from the, at least 2 centimeters above the placental, lower placental edge. Because the moment you go through it, there is torrential bleeding. So here we are just tying the, clamping and we've clamped, cut the round ligaments, and we've tied them. This patient had a lot of adhesions also because of the previous cesarean section. And then you make a window and stay away from the, so when we apply the clamps, the clamps should not poke into the uterus. So that is very, very important. And the planes have to be opened. You have to be, the broad ligament leaves have to be broadly open so that, you can reach the uterines even before you push the bladder. So that is what is important, because most of the time the bleeding is between the bladder and the uterus. So that is the last area. We don't give a bladder push. We don't push the bladder. Rather, we go open the, after we've done the fundal structures, we will open the leaves of broad ligament, and then reach the uterines. And then first take the uterines and then, so you can see this big placenta, which is here. So here the fundal structures have already been done. So we open the leaves of broad ligament, and that's the placenta here, that's the bladder here. So good use of, you know, cautery. You have to be extremely, extremely gentle. You can't, there is no need for speed here. So it doesn't matter if you're taking longer, but please make sure, because all these neovascularization has very poor muscular layer. So, you know, sometimes the cautery may not be very good. So in those cases, you have to tie these bleeders. So, you know, you, right angle retract clamp is very, very useful. So you can lift it up and, you know, while you are, see, this is a small bleeder, the way it can kind of came up. So you have to be very gentle. Here I'm trying to push the bladder a little medially. So I'll take the lateral window approach. And remember that the placenta is adherent only at the level of the scar. Below it, it is not adherent. So you can gently push the bladder, you know, on the lower, as you go a little lower down, it becomes easier for you to push the bladder. So here, you know, you can see I'm trying this bleeder. And how do you know that the uterine has been reached is you look for the insertion of the uterosacral. So the leaves of broad ligament are opened till the level of uterosacrals. Once you are at the level of uterosacrals, you know, once you open the leaves, and that's the time when you can palpate the uterine. Here, you just push the bladder. So this is the, I have opened the leaves of broad ligament. So I'm right there. That's the uterosacral you can see here, right? So the bladder has not been pushed. I'm trying to palpate the uterine. And then we don't, you know, take clamps like flushing onto the uterus here. So we use a right angle clamp. We first, skeletonize the uterine. And then with the help of a right angle, lift up the uterine. And I will pass suture. And silk is a very, very good suture. So, you know, I see, you can see the, this is where the, you know, uterosacral is. So you open up the broad leaves of broad ligament till this level and make sure you take care of all these bleeders while you are pushing the bladder medially. So very carefully, see, I can, you can see that the bladder is nice. Here it is adherent, but the bladder can be pushed. So once it is done, then with the help of a right angle clamp, I will pick up the uterine and tie it. So I'm not staying coming near the uterus, I'm staying away from the uterus. Remember, when you apply clamps towards the uterus, they poke into the uterus. And once they poke into the uterus, they bleed, you know, they bleed a lot. And it is also important that your assistants should be very gentle. Everyone has to be gentle. So one has to pay due respect to this uterus containing a morbidly adherent placenta, remembering that the moment you're going to touch it or you're going to be rough with it, it is going to kind of, you know, backfire. And then I don't keep too many clamps also here, because, you know, when you pull at the clamps, that starts bleeding. Another important thing is that when we are clamping, we clamp both sides. And see, the bladder here is again not pushed. So I'm just trying to push the bladder after the uterine has been taken. So the bladder is right there. That will be done the last. So this was one case, and this is the another case which I wanted to show you, where, you know, if you're rough, if you have too many clamps, then this is what happens. So any of the clamps get stretched, but then Green Armitage is a beautiful instrument. It is a beautiful instrument. It is even much better than the sponge holder. It can help you in, you know, clamping. So you can't leave the bleeding surfaces there. You have to make sure that you take care of all the, you know, bleeding which is happening, because it will take you time to do the hysterectomy. So another important thing is the bladder is usually adherent. So after you've done the uterines of both sides, that is the time when you start moving onto the bladder. And while you are doing the bladder, again, don't poke your scissors into the uterus. You have to be very, very gentle. Keep using your right angle clamp, lift up the tissues, and then you kind of, you know, dissect the bladder. Then there are a lot of bleeders between the bladder and the, you know, uterus. So all these bleeders have to be secured. Either you have to lift up. You can't, you know, have that cautery going into the tissue. If it goes into the tissue, there'll be torrential bleeding again. So all these small, small bleeders, either they are ligated, all these are neovascularization, which Sudarshan had showed us. So all these vessels have to be taken care of. And even after you've taken care of, then when you use your scissors, see, the scissors are used flat. See, I'm very flat and gently. I'm not going into the uterus at all. So it has to be very gentle. And once you do this, so automatically, you know, the chances of bleeding will be minimized. So this is, these are a few steps which I thought I would share with you.
Savita, can I add something, please, if you permit?
Please do.
Dr. Deshpande.
Sir, please do.
It's about the bladder. Separation of the bladder has to be done centrally because laterally there are plexus of Sanorini that may bleed. So you have to be very careful, very gentle, and you have to protect the bladder between the Doyle's retractor and the bladder. Keep a weight mop so that the bladder is not going to be traumatized. That's another thing. And clamps on vascular pedicle has to be mobilized very, very gently because just the slightest pressure, even they cut through and can come in your hand. So be gentle when you are doing. And most important thing, we know this particular procedure you are doing when the patient's BP may be 70, 60 or 80 systolic. Lot of bleeding is there from anesthetist to the nurse to the surgeon, everybody tense. So do not forget to count the mops which you have used in this particular procedure before you close the abdomen, or else you have to sing the song of Anuradha Patel, Mera kuch saman tumhare paas pada hai. And that should not happen with the surgeon when you
do hysterectomy. Very true.
Be vigilant, be gentle, and be careful. And OH is absolutely a simple and smooth procedure, life-saving for the patient. Thank you.
So, if I may also add that, so this obstetric hysterectomy video, madam, showed the patient was probably not bleeding very heavily. But in case you are doing an obstetric hysterectomy where the patient is actually bleeding very heavily, what was taught to us was clamp, cut, and ligate, that is CCL. We can do away with the L a little later. Clamp and cut, remove the uterus, then you can keep on ligating. So, you know, if you clamp and cut the uterus, remove the uterus, especially for a patient who's bleeding, then it is very quick procedure and it gets over really fast. And for these patients, the issue again arises, where does the problem come? The problem comes if the placenta is on the upper segment and morbidly adherent, it's a different thing. But if the placenta is lower segment and morbidly adherent, you have to dissect the bladder. You have to go below, and that is the area where it maximally bleeds. So yes, be very careful. So clamp and cut for hysterectomy, obstetric hysterectomy is where the patient is acutely bleeding, and you can keep on ligating things a little later. Mop count idea taken is very well taken, ma'am, because these are exactly the, you know, places where mops are forgotten, and then we have a big problem at our hand.
Manish, this is a clamp cut
just
and
add a point.
The removal of the uterus you like it is
we called want to emphasize technique. Yeah, I want to emphasize that we are going for the these type of cases. We go for the classical cesarean. That's why. Don't touch the placenta at all. Once you're planning for the obstetric hysterectomy, go for the classical cesarean. Then the placenta is quite away from that side. So bleeding will be less and we will be able to prevent the bleeding. Then we can go stepwise, as Dr. Manju has told. So then we can proceed stepwise. If we give the incision lower down, then the problem of bleeding is much more because placenta is very near to that.
I want to say, Savita, to Dr. Manish, that you know, the bleeding can be immense in case we cut through the placenta.
Yes.
And we are,
yes.
So even with all these care, the bleeding can still be there. But we always would you know, ligate the internal iliac arteries. And recently,
exactly,
our taught us that, you know, we just put a loop, we just tie it once. So we don't ligate them completely. So the loop can be removed later on also. But we, as a routine, would do bilateral internal iliac ligation. After the class, they're in bilateral internal iliac ligation, and then we move on.
Good point brought out by you, Manju madam, because these are the cases where, if especially if the placenta is in the lower segment, ligating only the uterine will not work.
This is
one situation where internal iliac artery anterior division has to be ligated.
Exactly.
As against other places where uterine may suffice.
Mitra,
yeah.
Dr. Narendra, you wanted to say something?
I just wanted to add about the internal iliac ligation before. And
yeah,
very nicely shown, Dr. Manju, I wish all my obstetric hysterectomies were that less bleeding. To see the planes so clearly, or the BP of this patient was very low, so that we didn't see any bleeding.
Now my panelists, please, you are role playing. You are not the efficient obstetricians that you are. Okay, calm down. So Dr. Pai, you are not the HOD of KMC. But for every attendee, what are the things
they should remember when they are dealing with these kinds of placenta. Dr. Pai, are you on?
Yes, yes. Thank you, ma'am.
Please, when you are answering this question, just imagine that what things should go flash in the mind of a person who is by themselves.
Yeah.
Okay.
See, as obstetrician and gynecologist, we know how to do hysterectomy. And I agree with Dr. Deshpande and Dr. Manju Madam that obstetric hysterectomy also should be an easy thing. But there are certain things that you must be aware of. Obstetric hysterectomy is not as straightforward as a gynae hysterectomy. So I call it the pitfalls. If you are not aware of these pitfalls, you will fall in the pit. And they are, number one, here the uterus is big. That's why the operative space is restricted. So you have to be aware of that. And not only big, it is slightly softer. Number two, the cervix is very soft and it is very difficult to identify the cervix. All situations, it is better to do complete hysterectomy rather than subtotal hysterectomy. That should be the aim of the obstetric hysterectomy also. The lower segment is highly elongated and you may leave behind some endometrium in the subtotal hysterectomy. That also should be kept in mind. The next thing is, all the vessels are greatly dilated and they are bleeding like, you know, big, big bore vessels. So you should have a, really what they say, surgeon should have a lion's heart. And of course, lioness, most of the gynecologists are, you know, ladies. So you should either have a lion's heart or a lioness heart. Then there will be varices in the mesosalpinx. As Dr. Deshpande and Dr. Manju's madam said, you have to be very gentle, gentlest of possible, especially with your assistants. Assistants have the habit of pulling all the time. So you must tell them, don't pull. There are lots of vessels, varices, and they will easily tear off. And there's excessive bleeding occurring sometimes behind. And all the tissues are very friable here. So lax pelvic fascia, unintended mole tissue dissection can happen. So as you said, madam said, it's very easy dissection. At the same time, flip side is the dissection becomes very easy. Slightest pushing will become very much pushing. So that should be kept in mind. And as I said, it is edematous. Everything is very edematous. And you think that you have done nice ligation. But after day one, it may be like reactionary hemorrhage. The ligation may not be strong enough. Then there will be distortion of anatomy. There could be some hematomas. There could be some tumors. So you have to keep in mind about the distortions. There could be excessive bleeding in cases of placenta previa. What they were saying is that what I agree with Dr. Manish, the most, it is called the most important principle of obstetric hysterectomy. It is not CCL, it is CCD, clamp, cut, and drop. You can leisurely suture later. So our idea should be to first stop the bleeding. And the bleeding will stop only when you clamp the, even in ectopic pregnancies, I teach my students, don't waste your time in clearing the peritoneal cavity screen. First, identify where is the ectopic pregnancy, clamp it, stop the bleeding. Then you have all the time on earth to clear the bleeding, to clear the adhesions, this and that. So then, of course, you have to use that principle. As I said, you should be very slow. I always tell my students, be slow to be fast. It sounds very paradoxical. If you are very slow and meticulous, without your knowledge, you will be fast. But if you want to be fast, you will be slowed down. It's like rash driving. So clamp, cut, and drop is the principle that we have to use. Now, because of the previous caesarean section, bladder is pulled up. Bladder injuries are very common. So I want to add what Dr. Deshpande said. Yes, I agree, you start the dissection from the center, but at the dissection should be sharp dissection. If you simply push the bladder, it will tear. So if you want, you can ask the urologist to come and help you if you want. And then there can be adhesions with the bowel. And bowel injuries are very common. And injuries to the vessel. And if the vein, if you hit, you are in actually blood pool. So you have to be very careful, very meticulous, very gentle. At the same time, you should be very strong in your heart. So you have to do things very carefully, then you won't go wrong. Hemorrhage, reactionary hemorrhage because of the slippage, secondary hemorrhage can occur due to left behind placenta. Here, I want to add, I was listening to Manju Madam talking about the methotrexate. I totally agree with her. Methotrexate is contraindicated for the simple reason, See, methotrexate acts excellently in molar pregnancy. Why? Because it is actively multiplying cells. Here it is not actively multiplying. That's why methotrexate will not act. If you have any doubt that the placenta might behave abnormally later in the postnatal period, better to do the hysterectomy. If you doubt the behavior of the placenta, that means it is just trickling all the time. And trickling is more dangerous than the gush of blood. Gush of blood, you are actually aware that it something is happening. Trickling, you think nothing is happening, but boon se ocean banta hai. So it's like that, trickling is more dangerous. Then of course you have problems with the needle injuries, thyroidal injuries, and all those things. So we have to be extremely careful. We have to be aware of all these things before we go, because youngsters are very enthusiastic to do obstetric hysterectomy. They feel that I can do it. Yes, they can do it. It is same steps, but unless you are aware where you are actually going, then just because you're not driving, you can't go into the jungle. You have to be very careful.
So thank you, Dr. Pai. That was very nice. Now, actually, we have covered everything, but it is going to be a fast recap. So because our theme was, so will you just go on to now? We know everything, yet when we tackle a patient in OPD, what are the things we are going to use to anticipate this bugbear? Dr. Pai, please continue. Just a quick recap so that we go ahead.
Yeah, I didn't get the question. Meaning in the...
This question was, actually we can drop if we want, but just a line on what are the ways an obstetrician should be vigilant on in the antenatal period. It's just a recap, but just go on with that, Dr. Pai.
So in the antenatal period...
So that they pick up this earlier than we face it.
It starts with the history. As we said, history of previous section, history of previous myomectomy, history of previous vigorous DNC, history of infections. So this history should start triggering in our mind. This is a potential case for adherent placenta. Then we start doing an ultrasound. In ultrasound, whenever the placenta is lower segment, again, it is a potential case for adherent placenta. Then you refer it to an expert ultrasonologist, or if you yourself have a very good high resolution ultrasound, look for adherent placenta. Mm. When you look for adherent placenta and you diagnose adherent placenta, it is better to counsel the patient in the antenatal period that most probably we will have to do an elective cesarean section. And
sorry, Dr. Pai. Just go on with that. We're not going with the management. Just recount that. And then because it's a recap. Yeah. So sorry for interrupting.
No problem.
Because
so that's all.
I just want a recap from all the participants.
Okay, ma'am. So to make the diagnostic thing easier, I was just searching through net. There is a scoring system, which depends on history of previous cesarean, history of placenta previa, then ultrasound findings, then findings on Doppler about the lacunae or the lakes that Dr. Sudarshan was talking about. And they have given different points. So there is a point system to it. And 0 to 5, I can share, I don't have the slide just now, but 0 to 5 is low risk. 6 to 7 is moderate risk, and 8 to 12 is very high risk. Now, if you have these risk scoring systems, then you automatically know which patients to shift initially only to a tertiary care center from which they will be followed up. So for that, I think there are some scoring systems on the net. It becomes easier.
What is the name of the scoring system?
TAVLIN, I think. TAVLIN. And it is 2016 scoring system.
Okay. Thank you. Dr. Manish, you should have given me your slide. Thank you. Dr. Narendra, just a quick recap of all the ultrasound findings for the benefit of some of them who would not have heard Dr. Sudarshan's lecture. Amit, please unmute Dr. Narendra.
Beautifully, we saw how we can differentiate past 0, 1, 2, and 3. And past 0 is when there are no lacunar spaces and there is it's only posterior covering the os. And usually this will, or anterior covering the os, and low segment past 0, we call it. So that will not give you a problem. Past 1, when you have a lacunar and that the hypoechoic area between the myometrium and the clear zone is obliterated. This also can be tackled without any major problem. Is a pass two, which is increta, where the hypoechoic area is not there and some vessels are seen in between the muscle and the placenta. So this is where complications will occur and bleeding will occur. And this is where you have to be very careful during the operation, ligate the uterine, ligate the blood vessel going to this area. And if it is completely previa, do a upper segment cesarean section, leave the placenta in, proceed for a cesarean hysterectomy and then go for it. Pass three is when it is percreta, going through and through. And this is where you need a multidisciplinary team. You need a urologist. Maybe before the operation, we could, someone has asked this question. I'm trying to answer all your questions on the type also, because there are many cross questions which are coming in.
Yeah.
Here you do a ureteric cannulation, the urologist.
We will come to that. We will be coming to that also.
And then we do a hysterectomy. If the bladder is injured, it is repaired. Sometimes partial bladder resection also may be needed. Partial bowel resection may also be needed if it is going through that. So that's how we classify them by ultrasound. Be prepared on what we need to do during the operative time.
Thank you so much. Okay, Dr. Hemant, I would like you to add a word on role of MRI. This is just a recap. Please don't start doing the hysterectomy. Just give an idea about MRI, where it is useful. Yeah, Dr. Hemant.
Ultrasound is gold standard to diagnose this particular condition. MRI may have only two advantages if you ask me. The extent of invasion in the myometrium may be reaching up to the serosa or may be crossing the serosa. That can be very well seen on MRI. That is one thing. And second, the thickness of the myometrium, how much it is there left. If the thickness of the myometrium is less than 1 millimeter, probably the placenta accreta is advancing towards the percreta, that you can see. Other than this, rest of the things, all they can be seen well on ultrasound. That's gold standard one. Plus these two things you can add. Thirdly, the posterior placenta. Again, one more important thing, which may not be easily diagnosed on the ultrasound. Yes, posterior placenta, accreta or percreta, that can be well seen on the MRI. That's the second advantage. Rest of the things are on the USG only. That is better.
Okay, Dr. Savita, please.
One disadvantage of ultrasound in obese patient, I think. Patient is obese and the ultrasound cannot pick up. MRI would be very good investigation in that case.
Very so good.
Maybe we add obesity to the risk. Yeah.
Weight
yeah.
More than 100.
Dr. Savita?
Yeah, Savita, one more case which an unbooked patient, yeah. And ultrasound misfired. Actually, it was diagnosed a placenta accreta on ultrasound, but opening, it came out to placenta percreta, whole of the bladder was involved. So the so much vascularity, it is 8-year-old case. So we kept the patient expectant, that delayed hysterectomy, closed the patient, closed the abdomen, discharged at 25 days. She came 1 month later on with excessive bleeding PV. So secondary hysterectomy was done successfully, but we lost the patient due to sepsis. Next slide. So the take home message from this is that we should doubt the ultrasound findings. It is not always secreta. We should be very, very well prepared for the placenta percreta, and primary hysterectomy is the need of the hour. So always, always go for the primary hysterectomy, the same sitting, and don't wait for the delayed hysterectomy, which previously earlier it was done. So the 8-year-old patient, 8-year-old case, when there was not such a concept of the primary hysterectomy. So these are
thank you very much.
Very vascular.
Okay, thank you very much. I think we have done everything. Just one. Now this is going to be a rapid fire. I just don't want you all to start doing the hysterectomies. Please just do what you're asked to do. Thank you so much, my panelists. So we are going to decide how to optimize, admit, when to deliver, where to deliver, etc., etc. And lastly, we will conclude with the consent, which is the very, very important part. So it's a rapid round, speed round. We have to catch up. So Dr. Hemant, how will you optimize the patient for delivery? Very important salient points. What are the important things that we should do?
It's obviously the preparation of the patient. Keep the patient's hemoglobin practically more than 12. Give the patient good bed rest. Most important thing, avoid her vigorous activity, avoid the coitus or sexual activity. Most important thing, give her antenatal corticosteroid for the lung maturity of the baby, because majority of this patient may have a preterm delivery or bleeding maybe at 32 weeks or 34 weeks. So let's prepare the baby also at the same time along with the mother. And obviously the consent and everything has been already explained. And the ultrasound, what I think personally, ultrasound between the 32 to 34 weeks is definitely going to help us to decide what exactly is the extent of the invasion and how we are going to tackle the condition. Because 32 to 34 weeks is the optimal period where you can do this. So nutrition of the patient, diet of the patient, keeping hemoglobin more, giving the rest to the patient, all these things are definitely going to help to the patient.
Okay, Dr. Narendra, this question is to you. Why is timing of delivery of such a patient so important? What will be the optimum gestational age? And what should be the time of the day when you want to take up this case? And why?
These patients have to be delivered before 36 weeks. That is a maximum. Any time between 33 to 35.4 or 35.5. Any additional waiting might trigger off APH because of stretching, because the placenta, and may cause a hematoma locally there. I waited in one case, and then when I opened her up on my elective CS, she had no pain. But the only thing I could see was a huge hematoma, and I said, never again, I'm going to wait more than 35 weeks. So it is very dangerous to wait. So give them steroids, do the lung maturity, and if possible, if they're living far away, admit them 2 weeks before. So admit them from 32 weeks onwards. Let them be there, make them comfortable, tender, loving care every day, talking and chatting to them so they're comfortable, and deliver them. Otherwise, 35 is my...
And a limit. Word about time of the day. Time of the day.
Always in the morning. Fine. Because it has been seen in a paper in Lancet, cesarean sections done after 11 p.m. in the night till 4 p.m. have the maximum complications. And especially those done at from 2 a.m. to 5 a.m. are the worst times to do cesarean section, because the surgeon is sleepy, the anesthetist is sleepy, the staff is sleepy, and the attention frame is. So always in the morning. I would always love to operate these patients at 8 o'clock or 9 o'clock.
Thank you very much. And Dr. Manju, now, what all do you think are important when you are
I have to be excused. Can I be excused? Because I have to go for a meeting with the district magistrate for the IMA.
Please.
Because
thank you. COVID. Thank you very much. Please accept our vote of thanks. Thank you. Dr. Manju.
Yeah, basically, there has to be preparedness in the sense that, it has to be a multidisciplinary approach. So there should be senior anesthetist, senior obstetrician, two senior obstetricians who should be there. There should be a runner who should go and get the blood. That treatment has to be there. There has to be a pediatrician. In case we are suspecting that there is bladder invasion or anything like that, then a urologist should be on board. And someone of the obstetricians, they should, in case you have, uterine artery catheterization and embolization available, then that person also should be there. Otherwise, the person able to do internal artery ligation, because you cannot venture upon it without doing internal artery ligation. So all this should be there. The blood bank should be sounded, and there should be arrangement of blood. It should be already available. They can't start throwing the fresh frozen plasma once you start asking for it. We should know that it will take half an hour. So your massive transfusion protocol should be in place, and that should be triggered. I think with all that, one should kind of go ahead and do the cesarean hysterectomy.
Thank you so much. And I'm very happy to say that I think I can reproduce all of this in Rivadi itself. Thank you so much. Okay, now Dr. Pai, although you have already enumerated most of the steps when you were covering, would you like to add something more about anesthesia? Hello, Dr. Pai?
Yeah, anesthesia can be same continued, whatever anesthesia they have given, that I will leave it to the anesthetist. The type of incision, because it is advised to do a classical cesarean section, it is better to go for a midline vertical incision for a better exposure and space there. And type of surgery, delayed hysterectomy is not advisable. It is better to do, soon after the cesarean. And blood transaction is welcome. Balloon occlusion catheters and all are told, but if you have an expert, you can use it. Otherwise, it is not actually necessary. Pelvic vessel embolization is also not a necessary routine procedure. Finally, iliac artery ligation, I wanted to comment that time only. Now I have got an opportunity. There is no point in actually going for internal ligation because if you quickly clamp, drop, and you can quickly finish the hysterectomy. Once the hysterectomy is over, the bleeding will stop. Okay, so because interiliac ligation is not at all an easy operation, especially for not a well-trained obstetrician. And with the big uterus there, I have seen even cardiothoracic surgeons, vascular surgeons struggling a lot. It's not that it cannot be done. It can be done, but it is difficult. You're wasting time. In the meantime, there's a lot of bleeding will occur. So instead of that, quickly clamp. See, ultimately, when you clamp the uterine artery, most of the bleeding will stop. Okay, so that should be our aim rather than ancillary procedures. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Dr. Savita, quick recap of a case, please.
Yeah. Yeah, again, one case. We are actually getting most of cases emergency unbooked than emergency cases. That was again diagnosed as a placenta previa, but peroperatively turned out to be placenta percreta with bladder wall infiltration. It was followed by hysterectomy and partial bladder wall resection by the urologist, and patient could be discharged after 3 weeks in a healthy condition with decreased mobility. So keeping this thing in mind, my question goes to Dr. Hemant Deshpande, how we can avoid or I can decrease the urological complications in a patient of placenta accreta where the bladder is involved. The days are not far when ureter might have been involved. It is so extensive. We are not seeing the case where ureter is involved. I'm just thinking it might be separate chapter in urologist book, how to deal with the placenta accreta cases when the bladder is involved. The days are not far when separate chapter has to be written by in the urology books. We always study the urologist for every case, keeping a urologist standby in our institute when a case of placenta accreta or percreta are coming.
Definitely.
Savita, I'll have to excuse myself. I have a meeting to attend. Can I leave?
Please, please. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you so much, Dr. Manju. Thanks a lot for participating. Yeah.
Dr. Hemant.
Yeah. Savita, I can say you. Urologist's role in placenta percreta is really important. The moment you see the placenta percreta, which is there in the lower uterine segment, that too anteriorly, causing some trauma to the bladder, damage to the bladder, a cystoscopy before you proceed. And these are the diagnoses which are going to do by MRI, which we are going to do by ultrasound. So a pre-hand diagnosis of placenta percreta, if it is with us, definitely we can ask our friend urologist to do a cystoscopic examination. May do even a bilateral ureteric stenting because that will be easy for us. And obviously, dissection of the bladder has to be very, very gentle, that too with the help of some part of the bladder you may have to resect, that we call it cystotomy, and repair of the bladder. That's one of the most important procedures which may be associated in the patients of placenta percreta. And what you have suggested, vascularization is one of the most important thing. Posterior approach, you all suggested. Even it can be done anteriorly, which you have shown when you are showing your video. The same way, if you dissect the posterior peritoneum and do a posterior approach and ligate bilateral uterines, it's worth. Even that can save the bleeding, that can stop the bleeding or minimize the bleeding. And bladder trauma, bladder resection, bladder reconstruction, cystotomy and repair of the bladder, all these procedures when you are going to involve in a percreta patient, urologist's role is really pivotal one. Must have your, because these are the surgeries to be done in tertiary care hospital and urologists are available there. As Dr. NM has suggested, do the surgery in daytime when you know the diagnosis. When you know it is percreta, you have to do it at 10 a.m. in the morning when everybody is available. Call all your friends, anesthetists, assistants, and obviously the urologist. And I think
Dr. Hemant. And from medical legal point of view, also urologist should be present at the time of bladder involvement.
Thank you. So these are all the surge complications which can happen in these very, very difficult patients. And now I'm going to call upon Dr. Manish for what he is really famous. So Dr. Manish, who's the chairperson of Ethics and Medical Legal Committee, please, I want your comments for the consents. And after that, I will request Dr. Sanjay Kishore Das to be there to put in his word because he's the chairperson of the Practical Obstetrics Committee. Over to you, Dr. Manish. The stage is all yours.
Okay. Thank you, ma'am. Without much ado, I'll directly come to two situations. Situation A, where antenatally you know that this patient is high risk for morbid adherent placenta. It is diagnosed condition. You have had time to discuss with the patient. You have had time to discuss with her relatives. You have had time to give her various treatment options. Importantly, from our side during counseling, we have to also tell the patient that we are patient friendly more than uterus friendly. And you know, this is one situation where the patient would land up, or mostly would land up in an obstetric hysterectomy. So a lot of counseling goes in for further fertility issues and all. So this situation A is okay to manage because we have had time to discuss. We have all the statistics to tell the patient. We have every procedure that we are going to do to tell the patient. Then obtaining a consent from her. So point number one is consent is a contract between the doctor and the patient. So consent is signed by the doctor and by the patient and nobody else. All other people from the patient's family are there as witnesses or as people who receive information. So this situation is good because we can take consent. Now, consent is again for 3-4 important things. One is what the procedure you are going to do. So suppose you are planning an obstetric or cesarean hysterectomy, then the procedure. Second is under what anesthesia. Anesthesia consent has to be separate. Anesthetists need to sign it. Third, very important is requirement of ICU, requirement of shifting to a tertiary care center if it is not a tertiary care center. Next point is involvement of other doctors. So for example, urologist you have involved or a vascular surgeon you have involved. Next point is transfusion of blood and blood products. This also forms a very important consent. And obviously a fair idea about complications. Now, if you tell all the complications, the patient will be scared. So what are the complications that can occur? So generally, if a complication rate is more than 10%, we consider that this is discussable. So some complication which is 1 or 2% may not be discussed. So once you put all this on paper, once you solve all the queries the patient has, I think your consent becomes good. It becomes a foolproof, nice consent. Situation number two is more dangerous because there either antenatally morbid adherence of placenta was not diagnosed, or she came to you as an unbooked patient with bleeding, or she's referred to your institute from outside with bleeding with a diagnosis, but you are seeing her for the first time. Now here, please remember, paperwork and consents come way later. First important point is emergency management of patient. So you are supposed to manage the patient. During management, if you are required to do a surgery, you can inform the relatives and get it done. Do not worry about consent. In emergency situations, to save the life of the patient, even Indian Penal Code Section 52 gives us things done in good faith without the patient's consent. So forget about consent, forget about paperwork. All that can be done later. A junior can go and inform the patient's relatives. You can inform the patient's relative and in good faith do whatever is necessary to save the life. In this situation, B, do not worry initially too much about consent and documentation. Even at that point in time, if the patient is bleeding and if you have to do a cesarean hysterectomy, or a patient during cesarean section, undiagnosed morbid adherent placenta starts bleeding and you have to do a cesarean hysterectomy, go ahead and do it. I completely again agree with what Pai sir said is, what is expected from a doctor from a legal point of view is what any other doctor, a reasonable man, would be able to do. So if a reasonable doctor is able to do an obstetric hysterectomy and not venture into intra-aortic ligation, perfect. No problem. Remove the uterus. Nobody is going to ask why you did not do stepwise devascular. At that point in time, in good faith, I thought this was best for the patient. That is what I have documented and I have done. So two different situations, two different actions. Where you have time, definitely you get everything in writing. Where you do not have time, do not worry about consent.
So that is really very good. Our collective aim was that all of us who are facing these difficult situations should move from emergency situations to elective. If we start thinking about adherent placenta, start giving it respect in our antenatal period, wherever we are, we can be safe ourselves and our patients. And also in emergent situation, definitely we need the consent of two obstetricians to sign the paper, even if we don't have the signature of the patient. So now I'm going to be concluding this whole wonderful panel, in which I'm sure everybody has gained by the immense experience of all my panelists. And just very quick message for all of us, the suspicion of diagnosis is most important with patients with placenta previa and with previous cesarean section. More vigilant if USG MRI do not confirm your clinical this patient. I really want all of us to remember Dr. Savita's sentence. If there is a placenta previa and if there is a previous adherent, take care that it is placenta adherent spectrum. In a small setup, refer the patient to higher center as soon as diagnosis is made if you do not have enough facility or backup. If caught unaware, don't panic. Keep patients careful planning. Think of the consequences.
Madam's Mitra, madam's voice is not coming.
Dr. Savita, you could take it up, please, from here. If you would like to invite Dr. Sanjay Kishore Das. If you would like
to take over, Jyoti. Yes, you can take over till the Mitra comes.
Dr. Mitra, and she was about to conclude with her maybe a few more sentences. I would like to request Dr. Sanjay Kishore Das to please come over.
I think Sita has shared.
Dr. Sanjay Kishore Das, sir, is there? He is
Hello. Hello. Hello.
Hello.
We can hear you, sir. We can hear you.
Yeah. Do you hear me?
Yes, sir. We can hear you.
Okay. It's a fantastic discussion. It's a really fantastic and learning. Very much thanks to Dr. Mitra and the team. And I must thank all the panelists who has narrated very discreetly, very neatly, precisely, concisely, and ethically also. Okay. So one thing I want to know, for the boarding obstetricians who are going to the field nearby, they have to learn certain things. In a rural setup, when a patient comes in the middle of the night with a retained placenta, she has delivered somewhere else and has been referred to you at the middle of the night. What to do? How to tackle the situation? You must anticipate it's a case of retained placenta. You must anticipate that it could have been a adherent placenta. Otherwise, you try then and there. Within a minute, you decide if it is a placenta adhesion, you can't do it in the setup. Just to refer it with the proper backup setup. And you must refer the case to a place where it will be properly tackled. Otherwise, the time will help the patient to go in the deeper situation. Number two, if you anticipate, it's better. You can prevent to some extent. You can do the cesarean section at the right moment, what we have discussed in the meantime. But if you are not finding, it is not a case of book case. You have not anticipated, and the middle of night, you find such a situation, you must know the tricks. Even if you are a good setup, you must be experienced by your seniors or friends or colleagues or somewhere else. You must have the exposure to tackle such situations. To speak everything is very easy. But to tackle the situation at the moment, take a decision and do the right thing in the right moment, it matters. So I once again thanks everybody. And once more request all the junior fellows to learn the tricks, how to handle such situation, because these are very emergent situation and you have to take a decision very fast. Over to Mithan, because time is very short.
Jyoti ma'am, excuse me. Jyoti ma'am, I think PC sir is there. Can we have his comments?
Yes, actually, Dr. PC Mahapatra, sir.
Dr. Jyoti.
Before that, sorry to interrupt you.
Call Dr. Mahapatra, please.
We are calling him. Yes.
Sorry to interrupt you. Before that, I request Dr. PC sir to just say whether it's a case of placenta accreta, can you go for straight away for hysterectomy or is there a role of to inoculate the placenta and put a suture to stop the bleeding and follow it up? Number two.
Yeah.
It is a case of placenta. It is definitely, unnoticedly, undiagnosedly a case of placenta percuta by a junior fellow. What to do? These are my requests before PC, sir. Hello?
Doctor?
Please
you need to unmute. Need to unmute PC, sir.
Yeah.
Amit, please unmute Dr. PC, sir.
Dr. PC Mahapatra, sir, please unmute yourself, sir.
Yeah. Is all right?
Okay. Yes.
Thank you very much.
I am communicable to all of you.
Yes, sir.
Thank you very much. I think I, at the outset, I must congratulate
every one of you, the whole of the expert galaxy of experts selected by Mitra, as well
thank
as
you,
the
sir.
Practical Obstetric Committee,
thank
the chairperson Sanjay Das, as well as the Medical Legal Committee, Dr. Manish, and the Rewari Obstetric and Gynecology Society, the Vice President Ragini, and everybody for this. I think it's a really a remarkable webinar and the history of the COVID-19 period.
Thank you,
as a practical obstetric committee and collaborating with the medical legal committee, I think it's a wise to select this topic, which is very, very common nowadays. Gone are the days, because we have a last evolution of the obstetrician for the past 4 decades. I have seen during pre-sonographic period, after sonographic period, and the different innovations and the different changing techniques in the management of this diagnosis and management of the morbidly aberrant placenta. Basically, I must say that obstetrics is a bloody business. And when it culminates in such incidents, it is a bloody, bloody business. I think that has to be remembered for. And basically, in morbidly aberrant placenta, one of the time when we were discussing before the sonography, whether it's a simple adhesion or a morbid adhesion. Now the spectrum has been very well highlighted after the sonographic demonstration. That is a spectrum disorder, and it's a placenta accreta spectrum disorder. The majority, fortunately, belongs to the placenta accreta, which is simple adhesion, which doesn't cause any problem, even manual removal of the placenta by vaginal or by cesarean is difficult. I think I have seen the only problem, the focus of attention, where the maternal mortality and the morbidity is more, is a case of morbid adhesions, which is either an accreta or a percreta. Believe me, the main highlight now, the sonographic evidence. Now the point is that, number one, we are gradually seeing the increased incidence of this morbid adhesion. Mainly obvious reasons are there, increased rate of cesarean section, increased rate of the different procedure, the hysteroscopic procedure, and this is likely to increase the incidence of the morbid adhesion. This is one. Second, we have got the sonographic and they're trying to think about the placenta. It's not that biometry is enough while doing a sonographic assessment, or the fetal growth is enough, or the fetal biophysical profile is enough. Every obstetrician or a sonologist should focus attention to see the placental bed and to find out. The history is very, very suggestive in a case of post cesarean or a post myomectomy or any uterine surgery for that. So this will give a really a planning, anticipate this from the sonographic, and a good sonologist. Absolutely, I was impressed with the Sudarshan's lecture today, that how you diagnose the placental morbid adhesions, and so that the clinicians will have get definite benefit out of it also. So this is very important anticipation. Now the problem is that till today we find very few cases are being diagnosed before the real incidence occurs. Now, then and there, you diagnose majority of the cases, you find and see that there is a morbid adhesion in these type of cases. That's the really the problem occurs at that particular moment, where you are not prepared for that. As Sanjay was telling, in a rural hospital where it has not been diagnosed and it's already, suddenly a gynecologist see that he has obstetricians, a young obstetrician see and faces this problem, then there will be a problem. It's nice to say that when you diagnose, and as per recommendation, when Narendra has already told that an elective cesarean has to be done in a good setup, in a good time, selecting a good obstetrician, and that will be fine for that. But it doesn't happen always for that. And at a time you find that you're doing a cesarean, you find that it's not a simple adhesion, it's a morbid adhesion. Even in a case of simple adhesions also, there are factors where you find the whole of the placenta is not morbid. The first of all, I will say that where is the location of the placenta? If the placenta is located upper, then it is really safer. If the placenta is located in the lower segment, particularly in the cesarean scar, it is more problematic, because it may invade the bladder also. It may be is a difficult procedure for hysterectomy and all that. And second important, what is the degree of morbid adhesion? Whether the whole of the placenta is aberrant or a part of the aberrant, one lobe of the placenta is aberrant. As Sanjay wanted to clarify one, that whether there is a conservative methods before hysterectomy, alternative methods to hysterectomy, you have removed the placenta and a lobe is left behind, you have removed the lobe, and if there's a bleeding, you put a suture. If the bleeding is controlled, then it's all right. But same time, seizure and hysterectomy is the norm for particularly the morbid adhesions. I fully agree with all the speakers that don't delay the procedure. By doing a stepwise devascularization, by doing a conjugative methodology, I think you lose the patient. Hello. By the time you decide for a seizure, for hysterectomy, patient is in a very low condition for that. And therefore, a seizure and hysterectomy is very, very important. And the person, the experienced obstetrician, is absolutely necessary. And experienced anesthetist role is also absolutely necessary, because it's a condition where the vitals are gradually deteriorating, and it's important to find out for that. And a good obstetrician, I think the techniques have been highlighted by Muralidhar Pai and many of the speakers, how to go for that. And therefore, I think a good hemostatic closure and a hysterectomy is very, very essential for that. One point I will tell that the urologist, I think the discussions were done for a urologist point of view. I think we must learn something about urology. It's not possible to call the urologist every time for that. Yes, bladder, ureter can be easily tagged with that. We are afraid of that. There's a urophobia is there. Urophilia should be there for that. And gynecologists can, obstetricians and average obstetricians can easily do that particular procedure for that. And that is more important. I remind that in COVID period, just 1 month back, when there is a shutdown in this area, I find one of the cases I faced the similar situation for that. It is a placenta percreta and encroaching and involving the bladder wall. And I had to do the hysterectomy along with the repair of the bladder in the same setting for that. In the dead of night, you can't get a urologist, and it's not necessary also for that also. And you are competent enough to tackle the situation for that. So I think the anticipation is important. And during that procedure, I think decision is important. Decision and both are important in this type of cases, where you take recourse to an obstetric hysterectomy in a much better way with the absolutely, it's me, don't be very much apprehensive, don't be very much fast and all that. Timing is important, but if you are fast and ultimately result in a very meticulous situations, in the not meticulous situations, you are gone. You can make a procedure much more delayed for that also. So during the procedure also, hysterectomy, seizure and hysterectomy, don't have a delay in hysterectomy. Decision is important, good procedure is important, and then that will solve the problem. I think maternal life will be saved because of this particular. One thing about the conjugative procedures, I fully agree with the recommendations of everybody and experience of everybody regarding the methotrexate for that. I think that's once upon a time it was a debatable. Now I think there is no place for methotrexate, particularly in these type of cases. There are some occasions where we have experienced that when there is a complete adhesion and the bleeding is, there is no bleeding, and those are the cases you can leave the placenta and give methotrexate. But these are the cases I find, two cases I found that these are the cases, the morbidity is really tremendous. One is infection, and second is pain, and bleeding could be the next consequences for that. And therefore, I think methotrexate, there is no place for that. And good meticulous technique of seizure and hysterectomy can really save a life of the patient. Thank you very much,
thank
all
you.
Of you for
thank
the
you.
Participation.
Thank you, Dr. Mahapatra. I am so honored that you were there throughout this webinar. It is immense respect that we all have. And you have visited us in Rewari, and you've had the pleasure to be with us and our family. And thank you, everybody. I will now call upon my president, Dr. Seema Mittal, and also Dr. Ruchi Saxena. I cannot see you, but I think you must be unmuted also. So both of you, please do the honors of paying respects and vote of thanks to all the persons involved in this webinar. Dr. Seema.
Mitra, let's say happy birthday to our...
Oh, yes. Yes.
Jyoti,
okay. I'm going to sing happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday. Happy birthday to you. Okay. Thank you very much, Jyoti. Seema, please do the honors of giving the vote of thanks.
Thank you, Mitadi. On behalf of Rewari Obs Gyne Society, first of all, I welcome all the panelists and speakers. And today the myth about webinar was broken. It was very, very informative. So thank you, Dr. Mitra Saxena, for all the wonderful job. I would like to thank Dr. Agni Agarwal, the president of Harobiji and our vice president Foxy, her ever smiling all rounder and walking journey. We have so much to learn from you, ma'am. Dr. Kishore Das, Dr. Hemant, and Dr. Sudarshan for most wonderful presentation. Thank you, sir, for joining us. Dr. Manish, our savior in crisis, it was a good panel discussion. Only one thing where I would differ from Dr. Manish, sir, I think somebody corrected in the end. We have to have every consent in writing and if possible in patient's handwriting itself. This was what was told to me by a judge. He said, we have to create a picture, a scene, and that comes from your papers, what you write. And even I was saved from cesarean hysterectomy because of the paperwork where patient relatives had signed everything. I would like to thank my favorite Savita ma'am. It was most wonderfully moderated by Dr. Mitra and Dr. Savita ma'am. Ma'am, you have given us unconditional support all the time and you're such a pillar of strength for all of us. And it was pleasure having you, ma'am. And Dr. Narendra Malhotra, sir, I admire you most. Actually, I'm your silent admirer because you have heart of a baby and zeal of a youngster. And so we would love to follow your footsteps. Dr. Parag Vinawal, I could see, sir. Approachable. And Manju Madam is the most adorable person, Dr. Manju Puri. And I think seeds of wrongs were sown when Manju Ma'am first came for CME to Rewari in 2000. Dr. Pai, this was the most impressive CV which I came across from all the panelists and participants. Thanks, Dr. Hemant, and for the valuable inputs. Mahapatra, sir, Mitrali has already talked so much about you. I think her throat was shocked when she talked about you. And we all have same emotions for you. And our glamorous beauty queen, Dr. Jyoti Malik, I think you make the show, actually. Thank you so much for being with us. And thank you, Dr. Deepika and Team Jackson Pal for such a wonderful discussion. We hope to have many more. Thank you, Ruchi, my DOCS members, and all the participants and panelists. Thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Seema. Okay. Dr. Deepika, please, you give your concluding remarks and thank you everybody once again. Seema had a good time speaking her heart out to everybody. Thank you. Dr. Deepika, yours, your turn.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you so much. On behalf of Jackson Pal, I, Dr. Deepika Chhabra, along with my teammates, Dr. Vipin Tyagi and Mr. Amit Saxena, we really thank you all the experts for taking out valuable time and sharing immense knowledge with all of us today. We at Jackson Pal would like to reassure all the experts our extended support in your future endeavors in the service of medical advancements. And we are really grateful to all the attendees for your presence. Without your support, this initiative could not have been possible. And with your continuing support, we hope to go a long way in knowledge sharing. Your active participation is truly anticipated. Thank you so very much. Thanks a lot, ma'am.
Thank you, Deepika. And one suggestion, lots of people wanted to enter and you had the ceiling at 500.
Yes, so we have just now, ma'am, we have just now increased our limit, but then by the time it could get increased, now we are up to 1,000. From next tomorrow onwards, you'll be finding seats up to 1,000. So Inshallah. Your next webinar, ma'am.
Thank you so much.
Okay, bye-bye.
Bye-bye, everybody. Thank you bye-bye. very much.
Thank you very much, all the experts, everybody.
Thank you all. Thank you all.
Thanks.